Today, I'd like to discuss the epsilon-delta proof. In most high schools, the definition of a limit is briefly covered, and the discussions on the epsilon-delta proof are often skipped or explained briefly. Today, let's delve into the epsilon-delta definition of a limit. But why specifically epsilon and delta? Epsilon and delta are Greek letters representing E and D respectively. Epsilon signifies error, and delta represents distance. Keeping this in mind will make it easier to understand the explanations I will provide. The definition of a limit is as follows. Let f be a function defined on an open interval containing c, and l be a real number. The statement, limit of f of x as x is approaching c is l, means that for positive epsilon, there exists a positive delta, such that if modulus x minus c is less than delta, then the modulus f of x minus l is less than epsilon. This can be abbreviated as this. How is it? Is it challenging to understand? Yes, it is. Let's break it down step by step. This limit expression means that as x approaches c, f of x converges to l. The expression x approaches c is not a mathematical representation, so we'll use the phrase the distance between x and c becomes arbitrarily small to describe it more intuitively. The distance between x and c is denoted as modulus x minus c, and for now, let's say the modulus x minus c is pretty small. Similarly, in the limit statement, f of x approaching l means the difference between f of x and l, expressed as modulus f of x minus l, is arbitrarily small. Now, when we express the notion of approaching as being arbitrarily small in both modulus x minus c and modulus f of x minus l. Next, we'll represent this notation of being arbitrarily small mathematically. The expression modulus x minus c is less than delta represent that the distance between x and c is less than delta, where delta is a small positive number. Similarly, the expression modulus f of x minus l is less than epsilon represents that the difference between f of x and l is less than epsilon, where epsilon is a small positive number. Now, using all positive epsilon, there exists a positive delta such that if modulus x minus c is less than delta, then modulus f of x minus l is less than epsilon. We can attempt to define the limit. However, it is challenging to define the limit with just this relationship because we don't know the relationship between delta and epsilon clearly yet. If we can find a delta that satisfies this for any epsilon, then the limit of the function as x approaches c exists. But how do you find this delta value? Let's explore this by looking at a graph. Let's take a closer look at the absolute value expression. If modulus x is less than 3, we can express it as x is greater than negative 3 and less than 3. Similarly, if we can express modulus f of x minus l is less than epsilon as f of x minus l is greater than negative epsilon and less than epsilon, and adding l to both sides gives f of x is greater than l minus epsilon and less than l plus epsilon. Then we can also express modulus x minus c is less than delta as x is greater than c minus delta and less than c plus delta. If you represent the value of f of c at the point c on the graph as l, and we visualize the f of x is greater than l minus epsilon and less than l plus epsilon expression on the graph, it means that f of c is within the epsilon radius of l. Now, all we need is to find a delta value such that for all x within the x is greater than c minus delta and less than c plus delta range, the corresponding f of x values fall within the f of x greater than l minus epsilon and less than l plus epsilon range. If we can do this, we can say that the function f of x converges to l as x approaches c. It is important to note that even if we choose a delta smaller than what is shown in the screen, f of x will still be within the epsilon radius of l. For all x within the x is greater than c minus delta and less than c plus delta range. Therefore, the function f of x converges to L as x approaches c. In summary, for any arbitrary value of epsilon, there are multiple possible values for delta that satisfy the conditions. Alright, that concludes today's video. I have vivid memories from my student days, spending a considerable amount of time grappling with an epsilon-delta proof explained in just half a page. Reflecting on that experience, I put a lot of thought into how to convey this content in a straightforward manner for today's video. I hope this module proves helpful to all of you. In the next session, we'll delve into several example problems using this proof. If today's video was beneficial to you, please like and subscribe. Thank you to everyone who has been watching. I'm your math guardian, Alex.